Welcome everybody to this very, very special International Women's Day event. My name is Jane Vadivalu and I'm the CEO of Children's Ground. Firstly, I would like to recognise the beautiful lands across these nations, the very, very many, many nations that make up Australia. I want to recognise the ancestors and the elders, the leaders past and present of these unceded lands. I particularly want to recognise the lands that I'm on, the lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation, and recognise Auntie Joy Murphy, who's a patron and elder of Children's Ground and senior custodian of these beautiful lands. I want to recognise the children, the adults, the elders, and the future leaders, and know that we stand as non-Aboriginal people behind the incredible leadership and history and legacy of First Nations people that have held the protection and care of these lands for millennia. I want to particularly recognise our incredible panel, who I'll introduce to you in a moment. But on this International Women's Day, I want to recognise all of our mothers and our grandmothers, all of the women that are out there today, the people who have fought, that shared a sisterhood, that have created the paths that we have walked on and that we continue to walk on. And the events in Australia over recent weeks have highlighted the important work that still needs to be done in our country to recognise the dignity and respect and rights of all women. I want to particularly recognise an elder who we laid to rest last week, Mrs. Palmer Mwari out in Alice Springs, who was a leader of Children's Ground, a director of Children's Ground, a visionary, had dedicated her life, and whose passing has left a huge hole in terms of cultural knowledge, direction, intelligence, and vision. And her vision that we continue to hold today and we'll continue to honour as we go forward. And now to our incredibly esteemed panel. It is an absolute privilege for me to be sharing the screen with these three amazing women. Mm-hmm. I'm going to speak to their bios first and then we're going to have a wonderful conversation. So first, to Dr. Miriam Rose Ungunmer Baumann, who's an Aboriginal leader from Nauru and a renowned artist, activist, writer, public speaker. In 1975, she became the Territory's first qualified Aboriginal teacher. As an art consultant for the Department of Education, she visited schools throughout the Top End advocating for the inclusion of visual arts as part of every child's education. She later became principal of the Catholic school in her home community before being appointed to the federal government's advisory board, the National Indigenous Council. In 2013, she established the Miriam Rose Foundation to bridge the divide between Aboriginal culture and mainstream society, driving reconciliation at a grassroots level. Through her professional and creative life, Miriam Rose has remained dedicated to maintaining the cultural independence of her people, being a spokesperson for the Aboriginal worldview. In recognition of her leadership, she was awarded a member of the Order of Australia Medal and an honorary PhD in education from Charles Darwin University. And of course, as you all know, she was held in great honor this year and she's Australia's Senior Australian of the Year for 2021. June Oscar is a proud Bunuba woman from the remote town of Fitzroy Crossing in West Australia's Kimberley region. She is an incredible advocate for First Nations languages, social justice, women's issues, and has worked tirelessly to reduce fetal alcohol syndrome disorder, spectrum disorder. She has held a raft of influential positions. She's been the Deputy Director of the Kimberley Land Council, the Chair of the Kimberley Language Resource Centre and the Kimberley Interpreting Service and Chief Investigator of Western Australia's Lilawan Project addressing FASD. June was appointed to the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Commission and was a winner of the 100 Women of Influence 2013 in the social enterprise and not-for-profit category. In 2015, she received the Menzies School of Health Research Medallion for her work with FASD. She has a bachelor's degree in business from the University of Notre Dame in Broome and is currently writing her PhD. She's a co-founder of Yiramalay Wesley School Studio School and is a community member of the Fitzroy Valley Futures Governing Committee. In 2017, she was awarded an honorary doctorate from Edith Cowan University. She was also named NAIDOC Person of the Year in 2018. In 2019, she was bestowed the honorary role of the Distinguishing Fellow of ANZOG. June began her five-year term as Australia's Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Social Justice Commissioner on the 3rd of April 2017 with the Australian Human Rights Commission. Brooke Boney is a Gamilaroi woman. She's an entertainment reporter on the Nine Network's breakfast program Today. And she is known for her incredibly vibrant, informed, strong opinion and reportage on everything from entertainment to politics, First Nations issues. She's formerly a journalist on Triple J, ABC, News, NITV and SBS. She's an ambassador to UNICEF Australia and a member of the Indigenous Advisory Panel for the Museum of Contemporary Arts. She is incredibly forthright, hilarious. Brooke co-hosts her Dream Club podcast with her best friend, Linda Mariolano. As the first First Nations person on commercial breakfast television, she believes we have arrived at a significant time in Australia. We are ready as a nation to start accepting and acknowledging our past and perhaps reevaluating who our national heroes really are. And I think that we can all agree we have some of them with us today. So I want to move to today, our special International Women's Day event, and the importance of this piece of groundshed work that was launched last year by the Human Rights Commission. They launched the seminal report, Wiyi, Yani, Thangani, Women's Voices, Securing Our Rights, Securing Our Future. It is a report that every single Australian should read. The Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Social Justice Commissioner, June Oscar, commissioned this report, created this report, and in launching it, she said, in every chapter, Wiyi, Thangani charts the imposition of Western systems since colonisation, the structures that have come to govern over us are so divorced from our realities that they continuously fragment our lives and relegate us to the margins. In a system without voice and control, women and girls describe being trapped in intergenerational poverty and powerlessness, increasingly vulnerable to the harms of violence and addictions that manifest from the despair of dispossession and unresolved trauma. First Nations women never stop fighting, even when exhausted, driven by that uncompromised pursuit for a society capable of realising basic rights and ideals of equality, inclusiveness and respect. The report is powerful. It brings the voices of First Nations women across these lands to life. It gives voice to the harsh realities, the uncomfortable truths and the phenomenal power and leadership. It looks beyond the cycles of crisis and allows women and girls to define their own image determined by them. So today in this virtual conversation, these three incredible women will discuss the key themes of their reports, their own work, and outline a pathway forward as part of a national conversation. So it is my absolute honour to welcome June Oscar to introduce us to the report and her vision. Over to you, June.
Thank you, Jane. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm sitting here on Punaba country talking to you. I am absolutely honoured and humbled to be sharing this platform with you all, and particularly with Miriam Rose and Brooke Boney. It's an absolute privilege. So I want to say happy International Women's Week. Not just the day, the whole week. Let's claim the whole week. And I really thank Jane and all the team, children, families, supporters of Children's Ground for designing this event and recognizing the vital importance of keeping Wiyi o Thangani, our women's voices in my Bonobo language, on our minds, in our hearts, and on everyone's agenda. And it's fantastic that Brooke and Miriam Rose can join us in considering how to do that today. And I want to say a huge congratulations to Miriam for winning Australian Elder of the Year. Your voice is so important in speaking of our realities on the ground. All of you, your voices and the backgrounds you come from are so important to this conversation. Thank you, everyone. And it is through gatherings, ongoing conversations, and making noise, as our great Australian of the Year, Grace Tame, said last week, that change will come, and I believe with enough noise and energy, we can achieve an intersectional gender equality in Australia. And I'll come back to how we bring on that change in a moment. But firstly, let me say, what a year it has been for us all. I can't believe the global shockwaves since the last International Women's Day. You know, as First Nations women, we do always say it has been a big year. Really, for our women, it's been a big few centuries, I reckon. And through all the ups and downs of history, we have survived. And in so many ways, we thrive. But the last year and the last few weeks have brought unexpected hurdles and new forms of pain, anger, and tiredness, frustrations for so many of us. And I want to acknowledge that today, that when we celebrate who we are and reflect on all our triumphs, as we should, we also know we still have so much further to go. So on this International Women's Week in particular, I want us to take a deep breath and recognize our power and potential as First Nations women and as women and girls from all cultures, backgrounds, and heritages. And remember that it is when we are in solidarity, in sisterhood, that we are an unstoppable force and we can bring about large-scale change. The Wiyi o Thangani report, a once-in-a-generation report, holds all of this power and potential. It is no ordinary document. It charts the diverse landscape of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander women and girls' lives, depicting what we have achieved, all of who we are, and laying out our aspirations for who we can become. And it talks about this across every sector and aspect of life, from community safety to housing, health, education, employment, leadership, and so on. For the first time in 36 years, this report has brought our voices together as a collective from hundreds of traditional countries across this continent. It holds the strengths of our ancestral mothers, the enthusiasm and hope of our girls and young women. And it depicts our ongoing legacy of female leadership, where our women everywhere occupy diverse and multiple roles. Yani Yodangani shows this clearly, that our women keep the home fires burning and communities functioning. They take kids and elders out onto country to share in the importance of intergenerational language and knowledge transmission. They keep businesses and offices ticking over. They constantly challenge and disrupt the biased and privileged assumptions of the mainstream. And they never fail to take to the stage and streets to fight against injustice and for the realization of our rights. We know our women, we do the lion's share of all forms of paid and unpaid work. And we do it all with care, with compassion and determination, with barely any compensation and remuneration. We do it because we believe that within our actions, we make the type of society that's worth living in for us and our children, for generations to come, not just for the here and now. We don't just do it because of duty. We are driven by the fact that we are constantly forming the social, political, and economic reality that we want, and a reality centered on values of belonging, connectedness, love, and interdependence. Our work, underpinned by immense knowledge, which women throughout Wiyi Yani Yodangani called the glue of existence, is undervalued and overlooked, sadly, by the mainstream. As if it is inconsequential to the current economic and social structures that govern this nation. Gender inequality, which disproportionately impacts Black, Brown, Indigenous women the world over, takes root because structures that are not of our own making have forced us to the margins and shut us out from forming the policies and legislation that impacts our lives. Wiyi Yani Yodangani catalogues across every chapter the real life harmful consequences of structural inequalities. Too often it causes a cycle of poverty where women and children are living in overcrowded housing with nowhere to go and inadequate income support, struggling to put food on the table, unable to find work, and constantly fearful of the interventions of a punitive child protection and justice system. I have heard countless stories like this, and I'm sure you have too. Alongside this lack of any meaningful support, the absence of our voices in spaces of power means that stereotypes fueled by racism, sexism, and misogyny take hold and go unchecked and unchallenged. The last few weeks have been a stark reminder that an all too likely outcome of this is pervasive violence, assault, and abuse against all women and girls. But in recent months, as we have all watched courageous women and survivors speak out, I've been reminded of the power of speaking truth and sharing knowledge that comes from lived experiences. This was always the purpose of Wiyi Yani Yodangani, for our women and girls everywhere to speak their whole truth, to describe on their own terms their issues, their solutions, and the actions we need to take today to realize the futures they envision. The result is that Wiyi Thangani puts on the table for all to see and read a First Nations female-led plan for structural change. It is ambitious in scope and entirely necessary if we are to confront and resolve the crisis of our time, all of which are related to entrenched inequalities. Women and girls have said it plainly. We need interconnected and joined up systems designed by us and formed from the ground up, which reflects and strengthens our holistic realities. In particular, Wiyi Thangani threads together four cross-cutting priorities captured in the report's overarching recommendations, which, if adequately invested in, could drive generational change in the lives of our women and girls and bring about First Nations gender justice and equality in Australia. These priorities are enhancing our leadership and participation in all decisions that affect our lives, supporting our law, culture, and knowledge systems as key determinants of health and well-being, investing in our healing work and initiatives to break cycles of intergenerational trauma, and recognizing our skills, responsibilities, and unpaid labor across all policies. Women have spoken to how these priorities relate to diverse areas such as developing better care infrastructure, mitigating climate change, embedding truth-telling in education, and enabling the emergence of on-country and culture-based industries and economy. These are the solutions and approaches that, if implemented, could once and for all break down the structures of poverty and powerlessness that have held us back and perpetuated injustices against us for far too long. And one overarching call for action, sung by all our women and girls across Australia to drive this agenda, is the need for our self-determination and to be guaranteed and backed up by structures of accountability and responsiveness. That is why the major recommendations of the report is to establish a First Nations Women and Girls National Action Plan and a First Nations Women and Girls Advisory Body that can guide, advise, and ensure that everything laid out in Wiyi Thangani is responded to and implemented. Australia currently does not have a national coherent framework to respond to our women and girls, nor does it have the architecture to achieve the many dimensions of gender equality. I can feel the restlessness throughout our sisterhood, through all of society, that enough is enough. The time has come for change. And to do this, we have to keep Wiyi Thangani on everyone's agenda. So all people, organizations, businesses, the media, and governments at every level are seeing, hearing, and responding to our women and girls' voices. This year, my team and I are doing all we can to pursue the implementation of Wiyi Thangani Stage 2. And I want all of you listening today to own this report and to have conversations with other women about how you can implement this report in your own lives. Ultimately, we must refuse for our First Nations women and girls' voices to be shelved. After this week, I would like all our listeners to keep up the mantra. I hear you, I see you, and we will walk together to deliver the change that must and will come. Yaninja, and thank you very much.
Thank you, June. That was absolutely phenomenal. And I want to move very quickly to Dr. Miriam Rose. Dr. Miriam Rose, that was an incredible introduction to Wiyi Utangani report and the important priorities of gender justice, leadership, law and culture, addressing healing and economies and breaking the injustices that are so prevalent across the country for all women and particularly First Nations women. You are incredible. You're an incredible leader. We congratulate you on becoming Senior Australian of the Year. Your distinguished career in education and your foundation and your commitment to culture and voice and amplifying the voices of your people, but in particular, your work in Dadiri, in deep listening, which I think when I listen to June is very critical in this journey. So I invite you now to speak to your work and why Dadiri and why this report is so important for First Nations women and girls.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you for inviting me today to be part of this gathering. And like I said yesterday, you know, children's ground, simple, but it's meaningful, especially for me, because we live in the remote area of the Northern Territory. And I told you yesterday that the whole community, the bush, is our children's playground. And, you know, being on country in that as well. But before I'd like to talk, there's nothing else to talk about. Look, June's covered everything
for us.
That was a beautiful speech.
We've just lost your voice a little bit there. Now I can hear you. Yes, sorry.
I'd like to say thank you to June. Can you hear me now? Yeah. For her talk this morning. And there's nothing left for me and Brooke to say, to talk about. You've covered everything. We're on Malak Malak land, so I'd like to acknowledge that that's where I'm talking to you from. I'm not from here, but I was born and grew up here. And look, we get on really great with the TOs of this land, the region. But the land that we're on now is owned by the Catholic Church, the Diocese of Darwin. And they leased it to us. Now, the people here are a community of 500 people. And we asked the church to come back after what I said earlier on. In the 1800s, the Jesuits were here and they'd come from Seven Hill in South Australia. We've got three shrines where the stations were, where they were based here. And the children here at St. Francis Xavier go there really so often to tidy it up and have a prayer or a reading from the scripture. Just a bit of a background of where I'm from kind of thing.
Yeah, thank you.
And Dadari is important. I'd like to say something about Dadari and also about the part that we play as women of modern Australia now. Maybe I say that first before I go into Dadari. And I was born in the bush on the banks of the Daly upstream. I don't know what year, what month, time of the year, but my mum said it was during the dry season. So the priest that was around at that time, when he interviewed my mum about where it was, she told him that it was in the dry season. And so he put July for me. And I've got two birthdays. God only knows which one's the right one. But anyway, I'm lucky to have two birthdays. I can say I'm 16 and I can say I'm 30, you know. Anyway, I grew up here and my dad died. And so his brother took on the responsibility of looking after me, and he was married to my mum's sister. So they naturally were, traditionally, were also my mum and dad. Tribally, culturally. So that was good. And guess what? He was a police tracker. So I had no choice, not even to even wag from school, because we live at a police station, you know. So I had to attend classes every day. Poor thing. And as I was growing up, become a teenager, old enough to understand what was, you know, living in communities and associations and all that sort of thing were about, and the service providers that came and went, sort of thing. And I kind of started understanding all of those. A teacher offered me a job as an assistant teacher. And so I was working as a domestic at her house. And then when I finished my chores, she come home from school and found me reading a paperback. And she said, oh, can you read? And she said, yeah, I can. And then she said, read me a paragraph. And I read her a paragraph.
I think she's frozen. Has she frozen for you as well, June?
Yeah.
Oh, no, what the paragraph said.
So we might just ask Chloe to contact Miriam and just see if we can fix up that technology. Hopefully she can come back in shortly. Brooke, maybe, we might wait for a moment.
Yeah. Here she comes.
Wonderful. We lost, you're muted, Dr. Miriam Rose, if you could unmute yourself. The technical.
Did you see that message there? Technical. That you could unmute her.
Ah.
As the host.
I think Chloe can do that. I.
Yeah, Chloe.
Can you do that?
Okay.
Yep.
That's better. Thank you.
Let's bring it.
There we go. I told you, Mob, I was electrifying, you know.
You are electrifying.
All of us. Anyway, you were reading the paragraph for that teacher.
Yeah, and this teacher been saying, you gotta come and work with me now for to be my assistant teacher. And in the meantime, she's looking for a place for me to go off and train. She found somewhere. So it was in Darwin, actually. And went off and trained. And then come back when I finished training and started working as a teacher here at this local school. But it was really frightening at first and scary in the sense that, you know, stepping up and taking the lead in that role, because we're still in that sense of the traditional way of living here.
Yeah.
And in that era, and I'm glad that I was born and grew up at that time, because there was nothing there to influence me to go the other way, you know?
Yeah.
Like, there's no alcohol, there's no fast cars, no TV, no mobile phone, no money, you know? But I mean, there was work that you could go and get some money. And it was great. Like, there's none of those challenges that young people come across these days, you know,
yeah,
that have been thrown at them for things. And, but there was this other thing in that stepping up and taking the lead and doing the role that I was trained in as a teacher, you had everybody's kids in the classroom or in the school. And so you could deal with families throughout the community. But the men were really funny, some of them, in the sense that, you know, when I started teaching them other things like the cultural aspects of who we are and what we're about, as in language.
Oh, frozen again.
And then robbery, passing on the Dreamtime story,
yep,
and dance, that sort of thing. Me?
Yep.
Yep.
You froze. Right. You're back.
Right?
You froze for a minute, but everything's okay now. Yep.
Oh. And there were some comments made to me and said that I wasn't to do that. And I said, I'm not doing anything that would interfere with the cultural aspects of teaching in the men's way, you know?
Yeah.
And I said, I'm only doing what I was taught by the elders and passing that on.
Mm. Wow.
Yeah. Thank you. And they then sort of understood, and they said, what are you painting? What are you teaching the kids in doing artwork? And then I said, they're painting the Dreamtime stories that you've passed on to me through my elders, you know, with the people that are around in the community that are elders and my family. And it's more meaningful and more creative. And then with the stories that we've got to pass on, it makes the kids own the stories that we pass on through art. It's creative instead of just sitting there talking to them and telling them the stories.
Yeah.
We could do that and then also illustrate. You're right, June?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But what they were fearful of, because at that time, as I was young, they were scared that they would lose their role as the leaders in our community. Mm. And I kept saying to them, no, I'm just a stepping stone for you. Because they started moving away and then all this thing coming, you know, citizenship and all that sort of thing. And then they could go to the pub and all that sort of thing. And I said, look, And then they started moving away from being responsible for the roles they had. And I said, look, I'm only just here to help you as much as I can, to walk with you and help you to be strong in what you're about, in what you got to educate our young people of today. Because the thing, the time's moving really fast for us, you know, and the pressure is coming from like people, the expectation that we get even today, you know, from the outside world, that we've got to pick, keep up with every Tom, Dick and Harry around the place sort of thing. And I keep saying, no, we're in a remote area. That's why I was late today, you know. It's a laid back place, the territory, you probably heard. And and when them Gadis, they come from wherever, they come and work with us, Mob. They wait for us at about 5:00. And look, like this morning, you know, I was running late to come to you. And I was glad that everybody else was waiting for everyone else. And anyway, and I said, oh, my God. You know, they're probably going to say, hey, how come you're late? And, you know, I was going to say, no, we're here. Like, we're in black collar time now. but, yeah, I had those sort of things happen to me. And then I started up American Arts here in the community. I was the founder of that, and it's going greatly. You know, we had a young boy a couple of years ago who won the Telstra Award here in Darwin with his artwork. And then there are others well known. And even my mom, she's gone now, 15 years ago. And at times she took the limelight from me. But look, I was the only one painting here. And then I said, okay, if the older elders is growling about me doing artwork with the kids and whoever else, I'm going to order a plane. The association can help me get a plane, and then we'll go to Manangreta, to Arnhem Land, and see what they're doing, you know. So we flew around to Tiwi and Arnhem Land for the day and then come back. And I said, see what they're doing over there. They're making big money with selling art, and women are working, men. So you can make money too, you know, by doing artwork. And through that art, you can pass on those stories, and it's more creative, because we don't have that time now that when I used to have, when I was growing up, you know, as a child, spent a lot of time with the elders, my family, my grandma, my granddad, my mom and dad, that sort of thing, in passing on those stories, and took me places, and we walked, you know, to these places, so that I was able to know the region and instill in us who we are through our language, our culture, our ceremonies, robbery, and the stories that we're supposed to pass on to our young. And I'm doing that now, still strongly with the young ones here. Sorry, I'm at the school and there's a guy around outside cutting the grass. Can you still hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. All right. So that's just a bit of myself. And you asked me about Dadadi. There's also a priest who helped, was the founder of this community when we asked the church to come back to live and work amongst us. And he said to me, pulled me up one day and said, hey, do you know that your people have this beautiful thing? Well, in my language, he said, it's spirituality. And I said, well, what's that? I was going, and then he started to talk about what it was. And he said, there was a anthropologist, William Stanner, He was in Canberra, he lived in Canberra, and he's set up a big office in Canberra. Now he's gone, he's left us, left this world, and he's got his place decked out with things that he collected from our mob and others that he'd worked with. And it's beautiful setup. You just walk into that office and get on a computer, and if you want to find what happened at Daly River at that time, yeah, it's all there on the computer. But he said, this priest, Father John Leary, he said, this is what this anthropologist found, and me, because I was with the elders a lot, and Dr. Stanner was as well, he says. And it's to do with being still and listening deeply and being aware of the surroundings. Deep listening, silent, still awareness. And it's about to do with the land and nature, the universe. And I said, wow, that's amazing. And he said, have you got a word for it? He said, and I said, well, every time we went out hunting, and if Dad was stalking something, he'd say, da-da-dee, da-da-dee. And that meant those words that I just said, deep listening, silent, still awareness. And I said, we could use that word to call it that, the spirituality. And then we talked a lot about it, and I started to understand what it was. And it's also a healing process. People today, like I was saying before, there's so many much challenges that we have to face, no matter who we are. You know, you've got to have the paper. If you're in an office in the city, you've got to have the papers in by yesterday. You've got to rush from point A to point B, and you're just rushing around. I've been to cities and towns, Melbourne and Sydney, and people are just 100 miles an hour rushing along the footpath and everything, you know. And I've lived in Melbourne, and I've noticed how people rush around. And I mean, just in Darwin here even. And I said, do they have time to sit still and listen and be in rhythm with the land? And, you know, today, June and Brooke, if we're here today, we wouldn't be here if our ancestors were connected. We talked to nature. It was because of them that we were able to survive, and we're here today talking at this session. And it was because we're very close to nature. We talk to nature. I feel stupid talking to this computer, talking to you. You know, and I'm here 100 miles an hour preaching about nature, talking to nature, and nature talking to us. And here I'm talking to this machine here.
Yeah.
I run weird retreats all around Australia sometimes. So I went to Townsville, the Catholic system there invited me, and this lady came to pick me up from the airport. And she said, wait here, you get your case. I'm going to just go and pay for my car. She said, yeah, all right, done. And I could see her from where I was standing, waiting for her. And then I looked away and looked around and looking at
wait for a moment and see if she comes back through.
There?
Yeah, we have you back, yep.
Oh my God, this is just, and for me, talking to you like this, I'm uncomfortable because I'd rather have you sitting with me on country so I can feel and understand and see your reaction and you interacting with me, you know, properly. You know, like yarning circles, just sitting around, having a meal and sitting, cook up and talking. But look, because of the COVID, it's amazing, like it's in, you know, we're in the digital era and technology in lots of way has helped us connect somehow. But I just reckon that I can't feel your spirit. You know what I mean? Properly.
Yeah.
And that's what I miss by not being able to do that. But at the same time, I don't want to get sick, you know, from that virus. I'm scared of that thing.
Dr. Miriam Rose, thank you so much for your incredible sort of generosity of your, you know, sharing your history and your story and the strength and your vision. And I agree. I hope one day all of us can be together in the same place, sitting on country and yarning some more. I want to invite Brooke into the conversation, if that's okay.
Yes. Thank you.
Brooke, you know, we chatted yesterday and this morning, and these two phenomenal leaders and women and powerhouses and, you know, cultural warriors and, you know, everything. You're the next generation leader. You're bringing your voice to the mainstream more and more. You're being recognised, you know, nationally for what you bring and how you speak to these important issues of our nation. So I want to now just invite you to speak to, in response to these incredible women.
Firstly, I feel so lucky and so privileged to listen to you two speak. You know, when I think of, you know, all of the strength that it takes to do big jobs or to have important discussions or to push forward, you know, I think like, oh gosh, this is so like overwhelming. And then I look at the strength that the two of you have and that, you know, what you've had to overcome and the way that you continuously push, it's so inspiring. And Dr. Miriam Rose, I would prefer to be up there with you too. Don't you worry about that. I wish I was talking to you through the screen. No, it's frozen again.
Yeah.
I don't want to cut her off because I just loved hearing her speak so much. But this report, congratulations, June, because it's incredible to have something that centres the experience of Aboriginal women and girls. And there are so many parts of it that I think are just so incredible. Obviously there are, you know, the four pillars I think that you outlined there that just sort of underpin everything. But the part that that I really liked and that really stood out to me was, you know, we can bring about large scale change and, you know, to think about who we can become. And, you know, I always think about that whenever, you know, something difficult happens and I feel like I have to use my voice to, you know, to participate in the discussion. And, you know, it does take a little bit of strength and a little bit of courage to do that because you know that there's a lot of people watching and, you know, that there might be people, well, there definitely will be people who disagree with what you say and that, you know, what you say is going to offend some people. But I always think about how, you know, have a responsibility to those girls who come after me and that the only reason that I'm in the position that I'm in is because of women like June and Dr. Miriam Rose who, you know, who fought so hard. And so, you know, it's just, it sort of speaks to everything that, you know, that we're trying to do and that we need to do. And so I just really commend the work and I hope the people who need to hear it listening, doing some of that deep listening that we just heard about there.
Mm. So Brooke, for you as a young woman, why is this report important for you? and for other First Nations young women.
It's important because people need to hear what our experiences are, and there aren't enough of us with big voices in public spaces to carry all of those stories, because some of them, you know, some of the worst of it means that you can't, or it's really, really difficult for you to push to a point where you can have your voice heard. And so to, you know, to put these voices on a pedestal and to bring them all together in a report like this, like you said, it's a once in 20 year report to bring this together. So it's so important. And, you know, I think it reminds me of, there was a report a few years ago about some awful things that were happening that the United Nations did. And it's one of those things where it's like, now that you know that this is how we feel about things and these are the solutions that we have, you cannot ignore it. You can no longer say, oh, well, we don't know what the answers are. We don't know what the solutions are to these problems or these questions that keep coming up. You know, people haven't told us what they want. And that's one thing that happens over and over and over. And I'm not a policy expert. I'm a journalist, an entertainment reporter mostly at the moment. But people always say, oh, you know, what is it that we're supposed to be doing then? Or how is it that we fix these, you know, these the gap between these outcomes? And we have the answers here, you know, that interconnected systems designed by and with the people who are affected by them. The answers are here, and this report brings them all together. So all you have to do is work with us to implement some of these strategies, and then we can push forward in the right direction.
Yep. Mm. And in terms of, I guess, mainstream media, where you find yourself and the challenge, I guess, of these incredibly important reports and voices being amplified, not just within the First Nations discourse, but in the national discourse, so that we hear the voices of First Nations women more broadly within our nation through, you know, the important processes that are starting to emerge through truth-telling and justice commissions, et cetera. How do you see the role and how do, you know, we break through into the mainstream media to amplify these voices more broadly nationally?
I think it's a really difficult task, because I think that a lot of the time the broader Australian community get a bit of fatigue when it comes to talking about Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander issues, because there's this difficult relationship that we have with the rest of Australia, where, you know, they've benefited from our oppression. And that's a really, really difficult conversation to have. It's a necessary one, but it's one that a lot of people are really reluctant to have. I think that we are at a very important time in our history, though, as a nation, as a global community, but, you know, especially as Australians, where people are more open than probably ever before to having really difficult conversations. And I think that the evidence, it's sort of just anecdotal, but I think that this year, around the 26th of January, the way that we spoke about it has been different to any other year that I've been a journalist. And it's only been 10 years, but I've seen a big shift in that short space of time. People are so much more willing to listen and to hear uncomfortable things, and to, you know that they don't personally have to take responsibility for it, but that they will be a part of the solution. Mm-hmm. And so I think that slowly, and the progress is frustratingly slow. Mm-hmm. I think that it is there, though, and that we are making progress a little bit. And, you know, even if you look at the way that our screens look now, there's so much more scrutiny on diversity and representation of you know, people of colour. Like, even in the last couple of years, obviously I'm now on the Today Show, and you've got the wonderful Norelda Jacobs, who's on the Channel 10 show. And just this week, the ABC put Tony Armstrong on their breakfast show. And so, you know, these things, they sort of, I don't know, like they're self-perpetuating almost. One of them does it, and then they all have to do it.
Yeah.
And, you know, then it's sort of embarrassing to be the one that doesn't have it.
It's an
Yeah. And so, you know, slowly I think we are having, we do have more voices in more public spaces. And, you know, even thinking about the incredible women who I'm friends with, people like Nakia Louie, who's there writing television shows, and, you know, Miranda Tapsell as well, who's on Channel 9 TV shows all the time, she, you know, mainstream television shows. I remember doing an interview with Kev Carmody at the end of last year, and it was one thing that he said that really stuck in my head. And he said that he remembers looking at his mother's Woman's Day, Australian Women's Weekly magazine. And on the back, there was this awfully racist cartoon. and it was this person, and they would beat their worker or their slave or something, and the person was an Aboriginal woman, and that was the only real depiction that they had in the magazine of Black women. And I'd literally just finished a big photo shoot and a big story with Australian Women's Weekly. And so I told him, and he was like, see, this is how it's changing. And, you know, this is why it's so important, so that, you know, people who pick up these magazines will see this sort of stuff. And I think that that is mostly true, even though it is painstaking and very, very slow, that there is more representation and those voices are being heard more than they have in the past.
Thank you. I'm aware of the time, and we might run out of questions, but I think it's our time for questions. But it's been such an important opportunity to listen to all of your voices. June, I wanted to come back to you, and I guess to respond to Brooke and to Dr. Miriam Rose, and maybe to speak to us about what you consider to be the next steps forward for this important report, and how we do amplify this at a national level. How do we how we make sure it becomes part of a national discourse and conversation to achieve the vision and the goals that you have within this report? What you want to see from those in positions of power in Australia?
Thank you, Jane, and thank you, Brooke and Miriam Rose. And thank you for those who are tuning in and your comments as well. Look, in response to that, and in the context of Wiyi, Yani, Thangani and women's voices, my main message in acting on Wiyi, Yani, Thangani is to keep up the conversations. We are asking all women and girls to gather in their communities and regions to think about how they can use Wiyi, Yani, Thangani to set out their priorities and to take action to respond in their regions. And if you've had a gathering or planning one, and I hope you feel inspired to do that after this panel today, that you can let me know and my team know. And we want to share your stories too and mobilise women and others from across the country to take action on Wiyi, Yani, Thangani. I believe we can achieve real change when we mobilise and unite. We're not alone. And change starts with conversations and noise. And as part of asking people to mobilise, we will be establishing a Wiyi, Yani, Thangani National Network for Action, where people from around the nation can share stories about what they are doing with Wiyi, Yani, Thangani with that report. And we are also beginning to ask organisations to make statements in support of Wiyi, Yani, Thangani. The other major areas that I and my team are working on is keeping Wiyi, Yani, Thangani on the Commonwealth's agenda, and we are putting it in front of all jurisdictional governments as well. We need our governments to listen to us and take accountability by putting the right mechanisms and frameworks in place, like ensuring that they support a summit and a national action plan. Now, up to now, there isn't one in this country for First Nations women. And I also want to make sure that First Nations gender equality becomes a cross-cutting priority across all portfolio and policy areas. Because our women do not belong to a sector or a single issue area. We belong right across, and our interest appears right across. Our women are everywhere and occupy and work across all aspects of life and policies need to reflect this. Lastly, please keep watch on Wiyi, Yani, Thangani website, sign up to our mailing list, and follow the Australian Human Rights Commission on social media. We will update you on all the work we are doing to implement the report. And we will be asking you to come on the journey with us. And as the year goes by, we will keep everyone informed about the different actions and ideas they can take to implement Wiyi, Yani, Thangani and ensure that key stakeholders and governments are doing the same thing. It's upon us all that we have to keep Wiyi, Yani, Thangani on everyone's agenda to fight and achieve First Nations gender equality and justice in Australia. So thank you.
Thank you so much, June. There's questions about what's the best way to get this report, and I'm assuming people can download it and they can also get a copy, a hard copy, if they contact the Australian Human Rights Commission. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yep. Thank you so much. Before I go to the panel, and unfortunately we seem to have lost Dr. Miriam Rose, but we will have final words from both June and Brooke before we close. I want to make a few final words. Firstly, Wiyi, Yani, Thangani is the most incredibly important report for First Nations women across this country. We have heard about the content of the report, the leadership of the report, the truth-telling of the report, and the vision of the report. We call on every single woman to stand behind this report, every single man to stand behind this report. We commend the report. We will do what we can to promote the vision that is within this report, and we ask all of you to do that. I can see in your comments that many people, June, are very, very keen to connect with you and also to Miriam as they further the priorities of this report, and I'm sure that they can contact you again through the Australian Human Rights. I want to, at this point, to recognise and, I guess, reiterate, you know, some of those wonderful words that if we mobilise, if we unite, if we make noise, that right now we are ready more than ever to have the difficult conversations in this country. If we listen deeply, if we take accountability, create the National Action Plan and do not stop until we have gender equality as a cross-cutting priority across this nation. I would like to thank this incredible panel for their leadership. I would like to honour the lives of all women. I would particularly like to honour the lives of First Nations women and those who have come before us, the leaders in our communities. And I think just listening to Dr. Miriam Rose, and one of the things we know, we have incredible heroes in every single community who are rarely seen and rarely heard, who lead every single day with incredible integrity, connected to the responsibilities of their law, their culture and their lands. And I want to recognise all of those incredibly silent heroes who just go about their work and keep their communities alive, their children alive, their families strong and their cultures true. I want to honour all of those. I'd like to thank all of the people who have joined us today. Please download and read this report. Please keep listening deeply. Keep your voices raised. Please support the work of the Miriam Rose Foundation and the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Social Justice Commission. Please create the time in your professional and personal networks and in your workplaces to have this discussion, to have the hard conversations, to bring to the surface what we all need to have as a priority in our lives. I invite you to continue to support the work of Children's Ground. We are evidencing and putting in place a new system that is designed by, led by First Nations peoples, cultures, histories, and a vision for future. We are holding the languages and the cultures across these lands. We believe in the solutions that lie in the true self-determination of First Nations people, and I invite you to continue to support this important work. So as we close, I would first invite Brooke to close with a few words, and then Brooke, if you could invite June, and then we'll finish today's session. Over to you, Brooke.
I guess I'd just like to say thank you all so much for listening to us talk today and taking the time out of your day to hear about something that's so incredibly important to us. And, you know, I've watched a couple of movies recently and had to do some interviews about the experience of Black women in the US. And, you know, throughout the Black Panther struggle, and one of them was about wonderful Billie Holiday, and I just kept thinking about the power of Black women in driving forward change in their communities. And that's also true in an Australian context, especially true in an Australian context. And I was thinking about all of these statistics, you know, the rate of hospitalisation because of family violence is so much higher for Aboriginal women, you know, sexual assault, all of these really awful things, they happen to us more than anyone else. And, you know, despite all of that, we're so determined to survive. You know, there's this sort of unrelenting will for Black women to keep going, and not only to keep going, but to bring their families and their communities with them, and to push it forward for everyone. And I find that so inspiring and so wonderful. And I think it's summed up in that quote that you said before about keep the home fires burning, but continue to keep our businesses sort of ticking over. That's just poetic and so, so true. And, you know, I think that the very least that everyone else could do for us is to support us in trying to, you know, make our women and girls' lives better, because there's certainly a lot of room for that. And I feel like, you know, now my life is a lot easier than what it was when I was younger. It's certainly a lot easier than my mother's life was and my grandmother's life was. And so it's even more important for me to be a part of this change. And so I, you know, implore you to be a part of pushing this discussion forward as well, and to put pressure on those with power to help us do that. And thank you so much, June, for listening to me speak, and for this wonderful report, and for your never-ending work. You are one of the women that I'm referencing, and when I say that, you know, it makes me incredibly proud, but also, you know, sort of gives me a kick up the backside to make sure that I keep going as well.
Thank you, Brooke.
So for closing comments, June?
Whilst we had travelled, you know, this great country of ours and listened to over 2,000 women and girls talk about their challenges and the things that, you know, get in the way of them achieving, we heard from them the amazing achievements that First Nations women are making on you know, many fronts, you know. And Brooke, you're one of our stars in your sector, and all the strength to you. We have women achieving in many spaces that, you know, whilst it was slow off the mark historically, we're there, you know, we're there now. Let's own our space. Let's speak as strong Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander women of this country, you know, following on from our first mothers and grandmothers and great-grandmothers, let's keep the lineage and let's hand this over to our children who are coming, you know, generations after, so that this continues on. We have every right to be speaking from our place, with our authority, within our identity, and we have a right to be here and a right to our voice, and nobody has the right to silence us anymore.
I think that's a beautiful point to end. Powerful. Thank you all on this special International Women's Day, International Women's Week. Take care, all of you, and strength to you all, sisterhood. Thank you.
Thank you.